Welcome to the Atlanta History Center. I'm Sal Salella, President and CEO of the History Center, and I'm delighted to have you here this evening at this Elson Lecture. These lectures feature, as you know, scholarly addresses by our nation's prominent historians and are made possible by generous funding from Ambassador and Mrs. Edward Elson. Our speaker this evening, David O. Stewart, will speak for approximately 40 minutes and then answer questions, as we usually do, from you all for about 15 minutes. And if you'd just speak out, we don't have microphones set up today, but if you just yell out from there, and if we can't hear the question, maybe you could repeat them for us when we get to that point. If you could also put in a plug for our Civil War Sunday coming up July 12th, I'll be on the program with Wendy Vennett, who's going to speak about Atlanta in the Civil War, and I'll be talking about a regiment from upstate New York, if that's of interest to you. David O. Stewart has practiced law in Washington, D.C. for more than 25 years. He defended the impeachment trial of a Mississippi judge in the U.S. Senate in 1989, and he has argued appeals all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court. His previous book, Summer of 1787, The Men Who Invented the Constitution, was a Washington Post bestseller and won the Washington Writing Award for Best Book of 2007. Please welcome David Stewart.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you coming out. Now, I'm going to do the same dance. Can you hear me? No. Okay. Is this on? Do I have to do something here? There's supposed to be somebody up there who guides me. All right, I'll just hang around here, huh? Yeah, that's better. I see that. Okay. I'm delighted to be here. To be honest, it's a slightly nervous. I've been out flogging the book now for about 6 weeks, but this is, I'll be honest, my first audience in the real South. This is a book about sectional anger, so let's walk through it together. I wrote about this story because, Sal mentioned, I did an impeachment case as a lawyer 20 years ago, so was interested about impeachment. I lost it, so I have some unresolved feelings about it. I had found the Johnson case very confusing. And if there are lawyers in the audience, you know if something's really confusing, you just sort of figure, well, what the heck? The other guy's confused too, so you just keep moving. But it bothered me that the first presidential impeachment was one I didn't understand very well. And after my first book, I wanted to do a book about sort of the next constitutional crisis. In 1787, the country was at risk of falling apart. And writing the Constitution was a tremendous exercise in bringing the country together. And I was looking for a moment when we faced that sort of crisis again and where the Constitution played a role. Obviously, the Civil War is a moment of crisis, but it wasn't principally a constitutional crisis. It evolved way past that. I'm going to try to focus my talk on two subjects. One way to be sure I actually end when I work on a book for a couple of years and go out and talk to people, there's always a risk I'll just keep talking. But first is, what was at stake at the trial? Why was there a trial of President Johnson in 1868? We had bad presidents before Andrew Johnson. We've had them since. And most of them didn't get impeached. So what was there in the air and what was in the water in 1868 that caused that impeachment to happen? The other subject I want to deal with is the factors that caused him to be acquitted. One of the things people tend to know about the case is he was acquitted by a single vote. You have to be convicted as president by a two-thirds vote, and the impeachers came up one vote short. And why? Now, the story really does begin with Abraham Lincoln's assassination, which was a tremendous emotional trauma for the nation. The war had consumed everybody for 4 years. It was ending, which was bitter for many, but also at least it was going to end, the killing would end. And only 5 weeks into his second term, Lincoln is killed. And suddenly the nation not only is to be brought back together, but there's a new man who will be president. And everybody wants to know who he is. Who is this guy? And at that moment in time, most Americans who knew anything about Andrew Johnson knew two things. One was that when the secession happened in 1860 and 1861, all the congressmen and senators from the 11 southern states had to make up their minds what they were going to do. Were they going to stick with their home states, or were they going to stand by the Union? And only one stood by the Union, and that was Andrew Johnson. He stayed at his post. He backed the Union. It was an act of real courage. His neighbors back in Tennessee, many of them resented it bitterly. He was from a part of Tennessee that tended to be somewhat pro-Union, though, the eastern part of the state. And he was military governor of Tennessee during the war and was exposed to tremendous danger throughout that period. And he was a guy with guts and courage. The other thing people tended to know was that 5 weeks before, during his inauguration as vice president, he'd been dead drunk, which was not so good. It's sort of an amazing story, or a totally amazing story. He was a hard-drinking guy, but lots of Americans were in the 1860s. The water wasn't that good. And he had been celebrating the night before, and he had a lot to celebrate. This was a big day. And he got up the next morning not feeling very well, and he seems to have had an attack of nerves. And when he got to the Capitol, he asked for a stimulant, which was the term that was used at the time. And so he poured himself three tumblers of whiskey. Now, they don't say how big the tumblers were, but it's not a shot. And he walked out and gave a just thoroughly humiliating and degrading speech. He ranted, he screamed, he whispered. He called on each cabinet secretary by name until he ran into the few whose names he couldn't come up with. It really put him in a terrible light. And he actually left town for several weeks and sort of recuperated and dried out at a local estate. And it was a terrific black mark for him because through his presidency, and he was president for almost 4 years, in a time of great controversy, it was not uncommon for people simply to say, oh, well, Andy's drinking again. Which is not a good thing for a president to have in the repertoire of responses to his policy initiatives. Now, he had been selected as Lincoln's running mate because Lincoln wanted to do what we would now call a move to the middle. Lincoln was a Republican. He was an anti-slavery candidate. That was the anti-slavery party. But he knew he was in trouble. He was going to have trouble getting reelected. His first vice president was an abolitionist senator from Maine named Hannibal Hamlin, who really brought nothing to the ticket. The anti-slavery people in New England were going to have to vote for Lincoln anyway. Who else were they going to vote for? So he wanted to have somebody on his ticket who would appeal to border state people, who would be a Democrat. A war Democrat was the phrase they used. Someone who supported the war and was a Democrat. And there weren't many. And Andrew Johnson really was the one who most fit the bill. There's no real evidence that they knew each other particularly well. They had both been congressmen at the same time in the 1840s for one term, 2 years. As military governor of Tennessee, Johnson reported to Lincoln. There's no evidence he really had any personal time with him. He sent in written reports. They had some things in common. They were both from border states. Lincoln was born in Kentucky. Johnson actually was born in North Carolina, but really lived most of his life in Tennessee. They were both very poor in background. Johnson probably from a more deprived background than Lincoln. Johnson never attended a day of school in his life. He was completely self-taught. He had been apprenticed to a tailor at the age of 10. It seems like the tailor shop was sort of like the barbershop in town where men would hang around and talk politics. And young Andy Johnson became sort of fascinated by all of this. And the men helped him learn how to read, gave him books. And he taught himself. He ran off as an apprentice. He was a pretty strong-minded guy even as a young boy. And made his own way in Tennessee. But there were big differences. Lincoln, as I said, had identified himself with the anti-slavery party. He was not the most rabid abolitionist in the country by any means. The abolitionists thought he was a bit of a trimmer. But he stood with the Republican Party. Johnson was a slave owner. And he never saw slavery as a moral issue. Lincoln could say, if anything is wrong, slavery is wrong. Johnson just didn't see the issue that way. Johnson also had a deep-seated racism, which lots of white Americans had at the time, but it came out in unfortunate ways. In one of his State of the Union messages, he told the country that it was now facing its greatest danger ever, which was that black people would get the vote, and they would Africanize the South. That was a phrase that was current at the time. And this was a greater danger than slavery. This was a greater danger than the Civil War. This was a divisive thing to say and an unfortunate thing. Another big difference between the two of them was we know Lincoln through his humor, through these folksy tales he would tell and stories of the farmer plowing his field with the fly on the horse's rump. And you know, he would clearly defuse situations with these stories and charm people and get them to like him. I was in Springfield, Illinois recently and learned that when he was a young man, former President Van Buren had come to town and they had selected Lincoln to have dinner with him because Lincoln was funny and they thought Lincoln would, you know, help Van Buren have a fun evening. Andrew Johnson was not funny. I looked for Andrew Johnson jokes. There are none. I looked for self-deprecating remarks, anecdotes, just anything. And there really isn't anything. He was a man of great dignity. He as a tailor, he had a tremendous sense of how you should appear and always looked very well, which is a contrast. Lincoln was sort of a sloppy guy. And I think it gives you a feel for another reason why his presidency was so troubled. He wasn't very charming with people. He could get angry. He could get angry pretty easily, and he didn't cool off for a long time. His bodyguard described him as the best hater I ever knew. James K. Polk, who was a Tennessee president, knew him and described him as vindictive and perverse. So he was a tough guy to get along with in some respects. So what was the country like? Well, there were, of course, brutal human losses. Over 600,000 soldiers had died, many non-soldiers, women, children, old people had died from disease, from dislocation, tremendous destruction of property. So it was a country that was incredibly troubled at that time. Everybody knew somebody who had been killed. If we were to suffer the same level of casualties today, we would have 6 million dead. A lot of people knew a lot of people who had been killed. And there were hard feelings about it. There was a lot of anger, bitterness on both sides. And that played a big role in the impeachment. But on top of all that, there was an unprecedented social convulsion that was happening, which is 4 million people who had been in chains were now free. And everybody had to figure out what that meant. And the freed slaves had some ideas about what that meant. One of the first things many of them did was just go walk around. They had never been able to leave the plantation without a pass. So they got out on the roads and went to try to find family members who'd been sold off, or they went to see what was on the other side of the hill. And they stopped working for a while, because they'd been working a long time. Well, this upset white people tremendously. First of all, the work was stopping. Times were hard. This was troubling. Who was going to bring in the crops? Secondly, they're walking around. It's black people. This was upsetting. And it got into every... reading the accounts of the people in the first few months after the war is just so striking. It's hard for us to appreciate how difficult it was. Every social interaction was different now. So when you pass someone on the street who was your master, who was your slave, who tips his hat to who? Who nods to who? Who gives way when you're going through a narrow passageway? Who is insolent beyond sufferance? And there was a lot of reaction like that. Because the freed slaves thought they had rights now. They thought they were citizens. They were, could even be giddy about it. How do you resolve disagreements between them for several hundred years? When there was a disagreement between the white person and the black person was always right. But then there was another layer on top of that, which is there were Union troops occupying the South. And they stayed until 1876. But right after the war, there were quite a few. They tended to be drawn down. Johnson didn't want them there at all. That was one of his arguments with Congress. But most of the white Union troops wanted to go home. They had lives to go back to. At the end of the war, 20% of the soldiers in the Union Army were black. They were either freed blacks or self-emancipated, a phrase I tend to like. And they didn't, in many cases, have good homes to go back to or jobs to go back to, land. So they stayed in the Army. At one point in Mississippi, there were 11 Union units. 10 of them were black. Well, not only do we have black people walking around, not only do we have them being insolent and uppity, but some of them have uniforms on, guns, and the ability to arrest you. This is a world turned upside down, and the white Southerners wrote about it. This was inversion. And just a flavor of it, because I think it colored the whole impeachment, comes from a report that Johnson, as soon as he became president, asked a Union general to go to the South and report on conditions there. And he picked a man I'm sure he was quite sorry he had picked, a fellow named Carl Schurz, who was a German-American and, as it turned out, a real radical Republican, not the fellow Johnson would have wanted. And Schurz wrote a very sympathetic report about what was happening to the freed slaves, because when you have this kind of inversion, you get violence. And that's really what broke out, was phenomenal, widespread violence. And he described being in hospitals where seeing Negroes whose ears had been cut off or whose bodies were slashed with knives or bruised with whips or bludgeons or punctured with shot wounds. Dead Negroes were found in considerable number in the country roads or on the fields, shot to death or strung on the limbs of trees. In many districts, the colored people were in a panic of fright, and the whites in an almost insane state of irritation. That phrase just always resonates with me, an insane state of irritation. I think it begins to capture just what the society, the social convulsion was at that time. So how did we take this, how does this explosive environment get translated into a conflict between the president and Congress? Because that's what happened with the impeachment. Well, there were really two steps that got us there, two big ones, a bunch of little ones. One was that Southern states needed to have governments. Ulysses Grant, right after the war, was terrified there would be anarchy in the South. And Lincoln had a plan, which he had used in Louisiana and Tennessee, for setting up state governments. And he always said, when you beat a man, you let him up easy. So it was a very sort of hands-off approach, let the Southerners form their own new state governments and begin to reestablish government. So Johnson followed that plan. And not surprisingly, what happened was the Southerners mostly ended up with former Confederates in charge of their state governments. This caused a lot of unhappiness in the North. There was a feeling of, what did we fight the war over? Just to have these same people come back into power. And it came to a head at the end of 1865 when the new Congress was about to sit. And the Southern congressmen and senators were coming up. And a dozen of them were former Confederate generals, former Confederate colonels. A half dozen had been in the Confederate Congress. Georgia picked Alexander Stevens, who'd been vice president of the Confederacy, as one of its senators. Well, when you look at it hard, actually, the Southerners had been sort of careful. They hadn't picked fire eaters, but actually tended to pick people who had reluctantly gone into secession, although then supported their states. But the North didn't see that distinction. They saw men who had led armies against them. Men, and this was said over and over in speeches and in newspapers, men who had the blood of our husbands and fathers and sons on their hands. And they were coming to take power. So what had everybody died for if the same people were going to have power? Well, this is when Thaddeus Stevens enters the story. He was a congressman from Pennsylvania. He's a wonderful historical figure, sort of a dark hero. He was a very committed abolitionist. He had been born with a club foot. He had an identification with the underdog always, with poor people, with the slaves, and then with the freed slaves. One of his colleagues said that it was as though every injustice that was done in the world was his personal responsibility. And he was ferocious. We're used to bleeding hearts being sort of panty wastes. Thaddeus Stevens was no panty waste. And people were afraid of him. They wouldn't debate against him because he was so ferocious. And he was a leader of the House. So they had the first session of the House, and he arranged for the clerk, who was his former law clerk, to call the roll. And he left off all the names of the Southern congressmen. So when they got to the end of the roll, the Southern congressman jumped up and said, "You left my name off." And Stevens stood up, and the clerk recognized him. And he turned to the Southern congressman and said, "We cannot recognize anyone whose name wasn't called." And that was it. And they went home. And for almost 3 years, Congress sat with no congressmen or senators from the South. Now, this made Andrew Johnson extremely angry. He called Congress illegitimate. He questioned whether a Congress that didn't have representatives from the Southern states could even enact legislation. And, of course, that made the congressmen even angrier. And they got into a spiral. I'll get to that in a second. The second thing that led to the conflict was the Southern states enacted black codes, the new state governments. And the black codes denied the right to vote, the right to sit on a jury, the right to give testimony, generally what we think of as your civil rights. They also often had a labor component. So black people had to have an annual labor contract that began on January 1 and ran out on December 31st. Had to run for the entire year. And if you didn't have a contract, you were subject to arrest for vagrancy. Or if you tried to break your contract or renegotiate it in some fashion, you were subject to arrest for vagrancy. And you would be imprisoned. And you could work off your sentence by working, by being lent out to the local landowner or plantation owner for no pay. It was a straightforward restoration of slavery. This made people extremely angry in the North. And Andrew Johnson's reaction to both of these situations was, the Southern states are sovereign. He had a mystical view of states' rights. He actually had the view that the Southern states hadn't seceded because they couldn't. It's a worldview I struggled with, frankly, trying to really make sense of it. So he thought there was nothing the federal government could do about any of this. And when Congress tried to do something about it by enacting civil rights laws, by enacting Reconstruction laws to put requirements to require black voting in the South, or to Freedmen's Bureau laws, which would, the Freedmen's Bureau was helping white refugees and the freed slaves adjust to the post-war world, he vetoed them all. Well, without any Southern congressmen or senators, The Republicans had a three-quarters majority in both houses of Congress, so it was pretty easy to override his vetoes. And it got to be sort of a dance, where they would do it in a single day. Congress would enact it, he'd veto it, and they'd override his veto. It happened a dozen times or more, and it was not, and this is what's important to keep in mind, it was not on trivial matters. This was the central political issue facing the country. And they were at war with each other. And it began, Congress became more and more aggressive, more and more unhappy with Johnson. And they began to strip him of his powers. So a vacancy came up on the Supreme Court. Rather than allow him to fill a vacancy, they shrank the size of the court. And to make sure that there wouldn't be a problem in the future, they shrank the court by two seats, just in case somebody should resign when the Senate wasn't in session. The central issue politically in the country was, or with Reconstruction, was who controlled the army. Johnson would fire any of the military commanders in the South who tried to enforce the congressional laws. Phil Sheridan, George Meade, lots of the heroes of the Civil War were fired by Johnson for doing that. And so Congress adopted a law saying that the president could only give orders to a single person in the military, and that was the General-in-Chief Ulysses Grant. They trusted Grant. But then Johnson had no power to give anybody else in a uniform an order. In fact, one of the impeachment articles that ultimately was brought against him, it was one of the two stupidest, was that he'd actually tried to give an order to the commandant of the District of Columbia, Garrison. The third thing they did to strip him of powers was the one that did directly lead to the impeachment, which was the Tenure of Office Act. And I love this because it deals with one of the elements of the Constitution, and I wrote a book about the writing of the Constitution, and I revere the Constitution and the framers and Franklin and Madison, and it's an amazing experience. But we have to recognize that they whiffed on a few things. And this was a whiff. They were very clear that senior officials of the government were appointed by the president and confirmed by the Senate. But they forgot to say how you get rid of them. So when the first Congress met in 1789 and 1790, they had to figure out what to do with this. And they enacted a statute saying the president may also fire these officials. Some people thought that was the wrong outcome. It was actually controversial because if the president appoints subject to Senate confirmation, maybe then termination should be the president terminating subject to Senate confirmation. Well, by 1867, after 2 years of Andrew Johnson vetoing everything Congress wants to do and undermining Reconstruction laws, suddenly that's what they want to do. So Congress enacts the Tenure of Office Act, which says the president can fire someone, but the termination only becomes effective if the Senate confirms it. And this is written by Thaddeus Stevens, and there's nothing subtle about it. He lays a trap, which, you know, a 10-year-old would have seen. Because it says, if you violate this statute, it's a high crime and misdemeanor. That's the term for impeachment. So he put down a marker. You violate this statute, you're going to be impeached. The struggle Johnson had with his own people came from his initial decision to keep on Lincoln's cabinet. And after a year of that, he drove several of them out of his cabinet and replaced them. And a couple of them, like William Henry Seward, came around, he was Secretary of State, and became supporters of Johnson. And one guy, the Secretary of War, Edwin Stanton, stayed in the cabinet. Johnson couldn't make it so uncomfortable that he would leave, and Stanton actively undermined pretty much everything Johnson wanted to do. Now, Stanton's, again, a remarkable political figure. He seems to have been one of the most difficult people ever to hold federal office. He was rude, overbearing, arrogant, difficult. He and Lincoln had a great working relationship. They would do this good cop, bad cop thing. If there was some problem that was going to require a no answer, Lincoln would send it to Stanton, because he always said no. And if it was a yes answer, Lincoln would keep it for himself and have a sort of chummy time with whoever he was saying yes to. But Johnson did not have that same relationship, and Stanton actively undermined him. He and Ulysses Grant did too. And it's sort of odd to read about, because Grant actually hated Stanton. Everybody hated Stanton. But they did cooperate in undermining Johnson's policies. So finally, Johnson can't stand it anymore. And I'm not a great admirer of Andrew Johnson, but you really can't have a Secretary of War who's not doing what you tell him to do. So he fires him, and the matter goes before the Senate, and the Senate refuses to confirm the firing. So he's stuck with him. So Johnson can't bear this. And without consulting any of his senior advisors, he decides what he'll do is not appoint a replacement. That would be a pretty good idea. But he says, they'll never confirm anybody I want to have as Secretary of War. So instead, he decides he'll appoint an interim Secretary of War. And he hits on this fellow named Lorenzo Thomas, who there was no particular reason for anybody to know him then or now. And his principal qualification for the job of replacing Stanton was that Stanton hated him. When Stanton took over as Secretary of War in 1862, one of his first actions was to assign Thomas to be far from the War Department, and for 5 years, Thomas had assignments out of Washington. But he came back in early 1868, got himself in front of President Johnson, and Johnson decided he would be just the guy. He was, frankly, a lightweight. He was an older fellow. He was a bit of a drinker. Apparently, he liked fancy uniforms. Nobody took him terribly seriously. It was an unfortunate choice. So Johnson told Thomas, you are now the interim Secretary of War. He gave him a piece of paper saying that and sent him over to the War Department to take over. And at that time, the War Department was right next to the White House, if you know Washington, where the old executive office building is now. And so it's 300 yards from the White House. It's not far at all. And Thomas walks over, and he walks in on Stanton, who's sitting there holding court with several Republican congressmen. And they have this Monty Python moment, which we have verbatim. We think it's verbatim, because several congressmen whipped out pencils and paper and started taking it down in shorthand. And Thomas walks in and says, I am the new Secretary of War. Please relinquish your office to me. And Stanton says, no, you're not. And Thomas says, yes, I am. And Stanton says, no, you're not. And they go on for a while. And ultimately, since Stanton is a man who is never embarrassed, he is never uncomfortable, he's comfortable being rude and unpleasant, finally, Thomas leaves. And Stanton thereupon barricades himself in the War Department office for the next 90 days. You have Lorenzo Thomas going to cabinet meetings and sort of floating around Washington pretending to be Secretary of War. In fact, Stanton sues him, asking that the court order him to stop pretending to be Secretary of War. And Stanton stays in the War Department, really not able to do much either, because his legitimacy is pretty well questioned as well. And it's an extraordinarily embarrassing moment to be an American. There is a wonderful episode that first night. All hell breaks loose in Washington. People described it as more upsetting than when the South seceded, more upsetting than when the Confederate armies were on the verge of invading Washington, more upsetting than when Lincoln died. People thought there was going to be a coup. There would be troops in the street. Blood would be flowing in the gutters. They just didn't know what was going to happen. So all these hyperventilating Republicans were running in and out of Stanton's office and rushing off and coming back and rushing off and coming back. And around 9:45, Stanton realizes he hasn't had anything to eat all day. And he's going to need some clean clothes in the morning. So he takes a sergeant. He's got an armed guard posted around the War Department. And he says, please go back to my home and have Mrs. Stanton give us some food and some clothes and some linen so we can sleep tonight. So the sergeant goes to the Stanton house, and Mrs. Stanton comes to the door, and he asks for these materials, and she says, absolutely not. And I want you to go back and tell my husband to resign and come straight home. They actually then had, in the next few days, they had several quite visible arguments out on the sidewalk in front of the War Department. But she had lived with Edwin Stanton for a long time, and they ultimately were reconciled. But there was a real fear of a second Civil War happening right then. Within 4 days, the House of Representatives adopted articles of impeachment against Johnson. It was a remarkable 3 months before. Articles of impeachment had been brought before the House of Representatives, and they'd failed. A majority of Republicans had voted against them. And Johnson had managed to take his victory and play it straight into impeachment. The trial itself took much longer. It took 90 days before it was completed. And that extra time, I think, was probably very good for the country. It allowed sort of the air to come out of a lot of the high feelings that were certainly in Washington, but I think around the country as well. And at the end of the trial, as I said, he was acquitted by a single vote. It's often attributed to a fellow named Edmund Ross of Kansas, who's a senator who's considered to have been the last one to agree to vote for Johnson. So what were the factors that led to his acquittal? Well, I'm going to give you five. You could probably do more, but these are the ones that work for me. First was who his successor would be. Of course, he didn't have a vice president. So by statute, it would have been the president pro tem of the Senate. There was a fellow named Ben Wade, a senator from Ohio. He was a rough-hewn frontier type. Ohio had been the West when he went there. In the 1850s, there was a famous episode on the floor of the Senate when a South Carolina congressman came and caned Charles Sumner of Massachusetts and basically beat him almost into a coma. And a few days after that, Ben Wade, who was also a strong abolitionist, came into the Senate, took two pistols out of his jacket and put them on the desk in front of him and said, if you want me, gentlemen, I am here. He didn't back down from anybody. There's a great episode at the first Battle of Bull Run when the Union troops were fleeing at the end of the day. He got out of his carriage. He had the people in his carriage turn over the carriage and try to block the retreat and make the guys stand. And he stood there with his squirrel rifle and tried to make them go back. He was not trusted by many Republicans. He was a real radical. He had untrustworthy views. He thought women should vote. He thought there should be a high tariff. He was very opposed to free trade. And as one newspaper article said afterwards, Andrew Johnson is still president because Ben Wade is his successor. A second factor was also just as political, which is some Republicans were very worried that if they were to remove Johnson as president, there would be a backlash in his favor, that they'd make him a martyr. And they had reason to be worried. They expected Ulysses Grant to be the Republican candidate for president. They needed him to win because this atrocity had happened to them. And I'm being somewhat facetious here, but Republicans had won the election in 1864. They ended up with a Democrat in the White House who was giving all the jobs to Democrats. Now, this was unnatural. This was really upsetting. And they wanted those jobs. And They wanted Ulysses Grant to win, and frankly, they were right to worry about it. He ended up only getting 53% of the vote. A third factor was that Johnson was willing to try the art of compromise, which was something he really hadn't done for 3+ years as president. It was not natural to him. But there was a senator from Iowa, a big abolitionist named James Grimes, who really didn't want to remove Johnson. He wrote to his wife that, you know, in the life of the Republic, two years with Andrew Johnson as president is not that big a deal. But Senator Grimes was concerned that many Republicans were afraid of what Johnson would do if he was acquitted, that there would be, he would be very vindictive, that he would turn on his adversaries, and that he would wreak vengeance upon them. He also thought having two secretaries of war was a uniquely bad idea. So he arranged for a meeting with Johnson. Johnson came to a neutral hotel room, and Johnson gave him some sort of soft words about how no friend of the Constitution had anything to worry about from him. I'm not sure why Senator Grimes found that reassuring, but he did. And Grimes told him, you know, you really need to appoint someone as Secretary of War who the Senate will confirm. And within a few days, Johnson did that. He selected a man named John Schofield, who had been a Union general during the war, of very little accomplishment. He was the single division commander in the South during Reconstruction whom Johnson hadn't fired. Johnson didn't like him very much, and neither did the Republicans, so he was perfect. And he ultimately did become Secretary of War. The fourth thing is, although you can tell I'm putting political factors high, the trial itself was, the prosecution did a poor job at the trial. The trial was prosecuted by the House leaders. Thaddeus Stevens was dying. He died just a couple of months after the final vote, and he couldn't even give a speech anymore. He was just too weak. And it was a shame. He was a remarkable figure, as I said. I wanted to tell this one story about Stevens. He was a funny guy, and he had had a fever as a middle-aged man and lost all his hair. But he was vain, so he wore a wig, and he wore a particularly luxurious wig. And if you see photos of him as an old man, you see this old man with this wonderful head of hair. And so after he gave a speech, some lady walked up to him and said, "Oh, Congressman Stevens, that was such a wonderful speech. May I have a lock of your hair?" So he whipped off his wig and said, "Here, take it all." But Stevens was really not a factor. Instead, the lead prosecutor became a congressman from Massachusetts named Ben Butler, who had been a very undistinguished general during the war, a political general. Grant and he had actually had a bit of a very angry falling out because Grant thought he was a disaster. He was a pretty smart lawyer and a smart guy, but he'd made some mistakes. He announced that he was going to try this case like a horse case, like a case of horse stealing, which had two consequences. One was that he fought over every evidentiary point, tooth and nail, which was boring. About a third of the trial transcript involves evidentiary squabbles that didn't matter because everybody knew what the facts were. The facts were not in dispute. A trial in the Senate is not like a trial in court. The senators read the newspapers. They know what's going on. So fighting over the evidence is just dumb. So he drug out the trial doing that. And I've been a defense lawyer for many years. When you're a defense lawyer, you want it to take a long time. You want people to get sort of confused. And why are we here anyway? It's just not that big a deal. And Butler played right into that. The other thing is he really did treat the president with no respect. And that was wrong. He was the president. This was a trial of the President of the United States, and he needed to act like that. And the defense counsel did a pretty good job. They had several. I'll just mention two. One was a fellow named Benjamin Curtis, who was a Republican from Boston, who had dissented in the Dred Scott case, so that gave him a certain stature, though he was a very conservative guy. And he made a good lawyer's argument. By all accounts, he was the dullest speaker they'd ever heard, but he was effective on this point. And as a former Supreme Court justice, he had stature. And his argument was, okay, the Tenure of Office Act isn't clear on whether Johnson had the power to fire Stanton or not. And he was right about that. It wasn't very clear, and I'm not going to go into that because it takes too long. But he said, you don't have to agree with me that he had the power to do it. You just have to agree with me that a reasonable person could think he had that power. And if a reasonable person could think that, then you can't remove him from office for having thought that. It was a good argument. The other defense lawyer who did well was a fellow named William Everts from New York, and he was the entertaining speaker. And he had to be. He spoke for 3 days. 3 5-hour days. But they all loved him. There's a wonderful letter somebody wrote back home basically saying, I know it sounds like it's really long, but it's good. And he was funny. He made fun of all the other lawyers. He made fun of everybody. And he charmed everybody. And it was a good thing for President Johnson. The fifth factor was one that completely surprised me. I had no idea of it going into the project and was almost ready to start writing when I stumbled upon it. And that was corruption. You have to remember this is the era of Boss Tweed. There was no civil service law in this country. 41,000 federal workers served at the pleasure of the president. They pretty much had to know somebody or pay off somebody in order to get their jobs. That was just the way it was. And our public standards were not very high. And patronage jobs and, frankly, cash were used to try to influence senators. Early in the impeachment season, three cabinet secretaries, Seward, the Secretary of State, Hugh McCullough, the Secretary of the Treasury, and the Postmaster General. The Postmaster General was traditionally the guy with the most jobs, postmaster in every town, got together and called in a consultant on corruption, a fellow named Cornelius Wendell, who had run a slush fund for President Buchanan. He had been the head printer of the government, and Buchanan basically gave him twice as much money as he needed to print everything, and the rest of the money was used to support Democratic candidates and Democratic newspapers. So Johnson actually brought him back and put him back in office. And the cabinet secretaries called Wendell in and said, so how do we do this? And he said, well, you have to raise $150,000. And then you have to use it right. And nobody wrote down what he meant by that, but I don't think it takes a lot of imagination. And we know from the records of the day, from journal records, diary entries, that there were at least two groups of senators, Republican senators, who negotiated for bribes. Three votes for $40,000, four votes for $30,000. And they negotiated with senior people in the Johnson administration. It's 140 years ago, and I can't put dollars in people's pockets, senators' pockets. But I don't think all that money was raised, and all those negotiations went on without some of it ending up changing hands. And the principal suspect is this fellow, Edmund Ross, from Kansas, which is a big reversal. Some of you out in the audience are almost as old as I am, and you may have read Profiles in Courage as a child. I was the kind of kid, I probably read it 5 or 6 times, John Kennedy's book about the heroes of the Senate. And he lionizes Edmund G. Ross. I went back and reread it for this book, and he actually says that Ross's vote for Johnson may be the most heroic act in American history. Well, I think he was paid. Within just a few days, well, first of all, for 89 days, he said he was going to vote to convict, and then the last day, he changes his mind. He votes to acquit after spending the previous 18 hours with two of the biggest fixers in the Johnson administration. Within days, he sends a letter to Johnson saying, would you please follow through on what I asked you to do, which was to appoint Perry Fuller Commissioner of Internal Revenue. Now, our revenue service at the time, the tax collectors, was totally corrupt. Perry Fuller was one of the dirtiest guys in America. He had actually bought the seats of both senators. This was a time when state legislatures elected the senators. So he had paid, there are Kansas legislative hearings on this, he had paid $42,000 to state legislators to elect the two senators from Kansas. He'd actually also bought a senator in Nebraska, but that he didn't matter for this vote. So he asked Johnson, would you please appoint Perry Fuller, head of Internal Revenue? And Johnson did. And the Senate would not confirm Fuller. They sent it back. But then when the Senate went into recess, Johnson appointed him chief of the Collection Customs House in New Orleans. And Fuller went down, fired the 90 Republicans who were working there and replaced them with 150 good Democrats. He only had 7 months in office before the end of Johnson's term, so he had to work fast. So he stole about $3 million. And he was, after Grant became president, Grant authorized the prosecution of Fuller, and Fuller was indicted. And the man who posted bail for him was Edmund G. Ross of Kansas. It's too much for me. There were other patronage jobs, chief superintendent of Indian Affairs in Kansas and Colorado that Ross got. There are other senators to suspect. John Henderson of Missouri was a very late convert to acquitting Johnson, and his father-in-law was appointed commissioner of patents just a week after the acquittal. And there's a wonderful story, and it's only from a couple of sources, I can't be sure of it, but that there were several senators who had been bribed to vote for Johnson, but their names were below Ross in the alphabet. So once Ross had voted to acquit, they knew that Johnson would be acquitted. So they voted to convict and kept the money. You know, what are they going to do? This is obviously a troubling element, but we all have to sort of step back from really this train wreck of a historical moment. I say in the book at the end, it's hard to find heroes here. But how did the Constitution do? Well, one of the striking things is that these people who were screaming for Johnson's scalp, who knew that there was skullduggery in this final Senate vote, accepted the verdict. This is not like the election in Iran right now. Nobody took to the streets. It was accepted. And it's interesting that it was, because of course, we still don't know what high crimes and misdemeanors really means. It's a phrase that comes from 14th century British law. I researched it a lot in my case and had lots of arguments with the other side about it. I had the same arguments in 1989 that they had in 1868 and, frankly, that the Clinton impeachment people had in 1999. We don't really know exactly what it means. The Senate has never said. Does it mean it has to be a crime to be impeachable? I don't think so. Some people do. Is any crime impeachable? I don't think that's true either, but some people do. And frankly, at this point, none of us can say we're right or wrong. I think it must be an abuse of office. It must be a bad abuse of office. Is that soft at the edges? You bet. I can't make a tight definition for you. The other thing that you find in the impeachment is it's both political and judicial, and that gets confusing. It looks like a trial. We call it a trial. We have charges. We have evidence. We have people voting to acquit or convict. It sounds like a trial, but it isn't. You have one branch of the government decapitating the other branch. This is the ultimate political act. And of the 54 senators who voted on Johnson's impeachment, I believe 54 voted for political reasons at the end of the day. And that's what it has to be. When the framers were debating impeachment back in 1787 in Philadelphia, Ben Franklin said, yes, we need to do something like this. Otherwise, the only thing you can do with a bad president is kill him. He was a very practical fellow. But it is true. It's often said that the true test of a constitutional form of government is, can you have a peaceful transfer of power between contending parties? In 1800, when the Federalists go out of office and Jefferson and his crowd come in, that's a watershed. We have a peaceful transfer of power. Well, an impeachment ratchets up the stakes. It's an intrusion. It's a battle between Congress and the president. It's even higher stakes, higher intensity. And it's a testament to the country, it's a testament to the Constitution and our political culture at a time when we were a very troubled nation, that it happened peacefully. And that's the best thing we can say of it. I would be very pleased to take any questions you may have. All military orders had to go through the Deputy Adjutant General, a fellow named Townsend, and he would get orders from Stanton and from Johnson and from Lorenzo Thomas. And he'd sort of finesse them, and from Grant. And he'd sort of make it all work. He was obviously a very valuable guy, you know, the classic faceless bureaucrat, but did a heck of a job. Had we been attacked in those 90 days, it would have been very difficult. Our only real foreign risk at that moment was with Mexico. The French were sort of still fooling around down there with Maximilian, but were not a threat to us. It was an internal struggle there, so we were very lucky. Yes, sir.
How did Johnson's behavior and policies change after the impeachment, and how did his relationship with Congress go?
I appreciate that question. He did not change in important ways. He kept vetoing legislation. And, you know, he believed what he believed. And he believed in states' rights. And, you know, if they were going to do something that took away rights he thought the states had, by God, he was going to veto it. As I mentioned with the Perry Fuller episode at the Internal Revenue Service, he kept appointing terrible people, which was not a great thing either. But the thing he did change was I haven't talked about it much, he had a real propensity to say outrageous things. He was a stump speaker. He came from Tennessee where you'd stand on stumps and give, you know, stem winders. He could talk for three or four hours. And he was an aggressive, hard-charging guy. And the Republicans figured that out very early. And they would heckle him. They would send hecklers when he was speaking to try to get him to blow his cool, which he would. And he would say, you know, he would compare himself to Jesus Christ. I mean, he just was really not good on his feet. This is why Obama uses the teleprompter. You can get in trouble. And after the impeachment, Johnson stopped doing that. He stopped saying outrageous things. He stopped ticking everybody off, and that allowed the country to sort of go more quietly through his final 10 months. He had hoped to be nominated the Democratic candidate for president. And at the Democratic convention that summer, he finished second in the first ballot. And he was very wounded that they did not nominate him, but they chose a fellow named Horatio Seymour from New York. Yes, sir. Everybody hears this? It is, of course, what-if history, which is fun, but, you know, you can't prove me wrong. I think Lincoln would have started down that road. I don't think there's any question of allowing the southern states to reconstitute themselves quite freely. He had done that in Louisiana and in Tennessee. Of course, the difference was there had been so many Union troops there at the time. I think he would have had a very different reaction to the violence in the South against the freed slaves. I think he would have had a very different reaction to the restoration of the Confederates to power and to the northern reaction. Lincoln was a very gifted politician. He wasn't perfect. We've made him this mythic, massive figure, which, you know, you have to remember in 1864, he got 55% of the vote, and the South didn't vote. So, you know, he didn't have a massive mandate. But I think he would have changed his path. I think he would have worked with Congress on some different way about it. The problems of Reconstruction were huge. And, you know, Johnson did, his presidency was calamitous, but it was a very hard time. He had to deal with more difficult problems than many presidents had before him and since. So I think for Lincoln, he could have had plenty of trouble too. The radical Republicans were not an easy group to get along with. So I think he would have been much more attentive to the political risks and would have brought more consensus. He also had a gift of language, which we all admire so much, which had a way of appealing to people's better sides or the better angels of our nature, which, you know, it's no disrespect to Johnson to say he didn't have it. None of us does. But that was a great loss. Sir. The question is, was the name National Union Party simply a temporary expedient for the 1864 election, or was it a separate party? It was a temporary expedient. Lincoln renamed his party the Union Party solely to fool voters. You can fool some of the people all the time. Johnson actually tried to organize a Union Party in 1868 when he, after his first year of sort of catastrophe with the Congress, he had this notion that war Democrats and conservative Republicans should form a third party and anoint him. And they had a big convention with 7,000 delegates in Philadelphia, and it just fizzled. It didn't work. So this notion of a Union Party was out there, but it just was for that one election. Sir.
So what was the epilogue with Johnson after he left office?
After Johnson left office, he was bitter. He wrote that he had been in the big city too long. He didn't like going back to Greenville, being far from power and affairs. He ran for Congress and got beat. He ran for the Senate and got beat. And in 1875, he ran for the Senate again, and he got elected. I had thought that John Quincy Adams was the only former president who went back to Congress, but Andrew Johnson did. And he served about 6 months. Congress was only in session for a short period of that, and he gave one speech in which he denounced Ulysses Grant as a new Caesar. He hated Grant. And he died that summer. So he did get some kernel of vindication. It's impressive. A lot of people in Tennessee, pretty much everybody in Tennessee, had a reason not to like him. You know, the Union people had a reason not to like him for Reconstruction. That those who had supported the Confederacy didn't like him for the war, and still he got himself reelected. So he was good in his home state. Sir. I do talk about it in the last chapter. The question is whether there was a risk Woodrow Wilson saw as of the...
Well, I think Wilson was a favorite. I think Wilson was an admirer of the British system, wasn't he?
I couldn't tell you if he admired the British system. I know that he thought Reconstruction was a disaster, and that he was very hostile to everything to do with the radical Republicans. And there has been a view by some political theorists that if Johnson had been removed, the presidency would have been crippled. I don't tend to think that. I think, you know, it's been over 200 years now. We've had three serious impeachments. They all happened, you know, we have a little data. It's not a lot, but, you know, they all happened when the other party controlled Congress. So that's one thing that has to happen. And every president had done something pretty dumb that had brought him into very low regard. And I think when you look at what happened in America after the impeachment, the presidency wasn't, the powers of the presidency weren't saved after the impeachment. The presidents who succeeded Johnson all had less power than he did. It was a time of congressional ascendancy. Really, without a war, there was not much reason for great presidential power until we got to a state of permanent war in the late 20th century. So I tend to be very skeptical of that argument, but it has been made a good bit. Sir.
One more question up there?
Yeah.
It's amazing that Johnson was able to come back in Tennessee politically. That is incredible, and I didn't actually know that he was reelected. The question is, what did the South think of him after this, particularly having hated him as much as they did, and then he ended up being their champion?
I always recoil slightly from questions like what did the nation think and what did the South think, because I don't know all of them. I know what people wrote down and what was in the newspapers. And, you know, it's always a problem we come up against, which is all the people who couldn't write. We don't know what they thought. But I will play along, of course. There was, it seemed from the reading I've been able to do, the Southerners figured out very soon after he took office that he was going to be their friend. And they cherished that. His first amnesty program, and he had about four, he kept progressively giving amnesty to more and more of the former Confederates. But his first one was really odd in that he gave amnesty to all except a few categories, and one of the categories was people whose net worth was over $20,000. He had always been a poor boy. Of course, he'd been a successful adult, but he had a poor boy's resentment of rich people. And so, frankly, all the rich people of the South had to go to Washington to get their pardons personally from the president. And in about a six-month period, he entertained approximately 7,000 wealthy Southerners. And when you read the descriptions of what the ante rooms in the White House are like, it seems just a very odd time. And Republicans were appalled by this because he was spending all his time with Southern people, and they felt like he was being captured by their views. But the longer he was in office, the more Southern he became in his outlook, and the less wedded to, you know, the Union cause. Obviously, he'd had these terrible arguments with the radical Republicans. So I think there was a strongly positive view by many of Southerners towards him. Thanks very much. Thank you.